There are indications, though, that this was not a foregone conclusion. Prosecutors clearly had doubts about their ridiculously shaky case. One indication of this is the remarkable fact that, though the case was moved some 3 hours outside of Chicago to Peoria, the judge stayed on in the new venue, an unprecedented development. This same judge slapped a gag order on the press, guaranteeing that no news would get back to Chicago, or anywhere else in the country for that matter. Coupled with the blocking of any interviews with Amorau, this action shut the public out from ever learning the weakness of the case against Speck. But no matter. Authorities and the press had already assured everyone that Speck was guilty. And the public was hungry for a culprit to hang this heinous crime on. Speck would do just fine. But many of the more thoughtful citizens of Chicago are still waiting to learn what really happened in that house on that fateful night. The most likely explanation? The survivor and star witness was not actually a survivor at all. She was quite possibly an accomplice to a cult of individuals who perpetrated this slaughter. She was, as they say, the inside man. And it was not likely an accident that she was left alive. It was absolutely essential that she remain alive to sell the single assailant scenario and thereby derail an investigation before it ever began. After all, authorities had noted from the beginning that the house was not highly visible and had immediately assumed familiarity of the killer with the surroundings. Speck did not have this familiarity, though Amorau certainly did. And it is likely not a coincidence that Amorau admitted to being the one to let the killer, or killers, into the house, while ironically becoming the sole survivor. And what of Speck? He was likely little more than a patsy or fall guy. He may have had some involvement with the killings, though he certainly was not the sole assailant. And he might not have been in the house at all that night. He had no memory of ever leaving the bar that he had been drinking in earlier that evening, though he did remember receiving an injection from a man he didn't know that was supposed to contain speed. It's possible that, like David Berkowitz, he may have taken the fall to protect the rest of the clan. This would certainly explain the preposterously lax treatment of Speck during his confinement. Or maybe you didn't catch that little home videotape, produced circa 1988, that depicted Speck snorting huge piles of cocaine and flashing rolls of money, not to mention sporting a rather large and quite unattractive pair of breasts. How it is possible that one of America's most notorious killers, while residing in what is reputedly one of the toughest prisons in the country, was able to obtain copious quantities of drugs and money and gain access to video equipment and hormone treatments has never been explained. It could be that Speck was rewarded in prison for being such a stand-up guy and taking the fall. Or it could be, as the right-wing Law and Order crowd would have you believe, that this is yet another indication of how America coddles its criminals. If you choose this explanation, however, you might consider explaining that fact to the hundreds of thousands of non-violent offenders rotting away in jails and prisons all across this country, many serving longer sentences than some of America's serial killers have served. And you might also ponder why it was that Speck's death sentence was overturned on appeal, leaving him eligible for parole in just 10 years. Footnote: a couple weeks after the Chicago slaughter, Charles Whitman, a former Marine who had received training by the Naval Enlisted Science Education Program, NESP, an intelligence entity, would climb the tower at the University of Texas carrying 3 rifles, 3 handguns and a shotgun, and proceed to open fire, killing 16. Whitman would leave a note which read, in part, "I don't quite understand what is compelling me to type this note. I have been to a psychiatrist. I have been having fears and violent impulses." Both of these mass murders occurred, strangely enough, just a few months after Anton LaVey had formally established the Church of Satan and declared April 30, 1966 to be the first day of the Age of Satan. Just a few weeks prior to that, longtime CIA asset Henry Luce's venerable Time magazine had asked its readers the symbolic question, "Is God dead?" The face of a particularly brutal criminal enterprise, masquerading as a religion, was beginning to emerge from the shadows. "I must have done it, if everybody says I did. Richard Speck." Part 3, 7 Degrees of Henry Lee. July 2000. Can I tell you who really I am, with all the secrecy that's in the family? I only have one purpose in life, and that's to express some of my views and some of the views that I have been instructed, anything that can put down Christianity, anything that can put down democracy, anything that can put down freedom. Rafael Reisandez Ramirez, delivering his closing argument to a jury in St. Louis, March 1989. Henry's reign of terror had been ended for a mere 9 months when another series of violent serial killings began on March 27, 1984 in part of Henry's old stomping ground, the state of Florida, where Reisandez Ramirez also confessed to having committed two murders. By the time it was over, 10 people had met with a gruesome death, allegedly at the hands of Bobby Joe Long. Though rarely mentioned in press accounts of the killings, Long is a distant cousin of Henry Lee Lucas. It had been just over 2 years since John Wayne Gacy had been indicted for the murder of 33 young men in Chicago when the first of a new wave of serial killings began terrorizing the people of the Windy City. A year and a half later, 17 young women had fallen victim to the Ripper crew, led by Robin Jecht. Though infrequently mentioned, Jecht had been one of the young male employees of John Gacy. 17 years later, just days prior to the scheduled execution of one of the Rippers, David Jecht, son of Robin, would be arrested along with three accomplices and charged with committing an act of murder. The odds that it is merely coincidence that two serial killers worked side by side without either having awareness of, or involvement in, the other's killings are surely astronomical. More likely is that Jecht was a member of a cult led by Gacy and was indeed involved in the earlier series of killings. Well documented is that Gacy surrounded himself with young men and boys, one of whom was Robin Jecht. Also documented is that Gacy had these boys excavate the 29 graves located directly beneath his house. While it is claimed that the boys were unaware that what they were digging were graves, how credible is this claim? The stench of death permeating the space beneath Gacy's house, and indeed the house itself, was universally described as overwhelming. It seems entirely possible that those digging the graves, and likely burying the bodies as well, were teen cultists led by Gacy himself. The home was likely used as something of a safe house for the cult, as well as a body drop. Following the arrest of Gacy, the group, now under the leadership of Jecht, was likely forced to take its activities out onto the streets, so to speak. The change in gender of the victims could be due to one of two factors: a deliberate attempt to disassociate the Ripper killings from the Gacy killings, or simply a reflection of the difference in sexual preference between Gacy and Jecht. At any rate, it is an acknowledged fact that the Ripper crew was a satanic cult that killed as a group, much as did the Manson family. Prosecutors in fact likened Jecht's followers to the family, who yearned to please their leader and killed on command. As mentioned in part 1 of this series, the string of shootings dubbed the Son of Sam murders were not, as is generally believed, the work of David Berkowitz acting alone, but were likewise the work of a satanic cult. This case has been exhaustively researched by Maury Terry and documented in his book, The Ultimate Evil. An offshoot of the process Church of the Final Judgment, the cult has been referred to as both the Qing'an cult and the 4P cult. The process church, which set up shop in San Francisco, was itself an offshoot of the Church of Scientology, which was the brainchild of L. Ron Hubbard, an agent of the Office of Naval Intelligence and the son of a U.S. Navy commander. Before being inspired to create his own church, Hubbard was a close associate and follower of Jack Parsons, rocket fuel scientist and avid follower of the occult, who helped found the prestigious Jet Propulsion Laboratory in Pasadena, California. Parsons was at the time the head of the American chapter of the Ordo, Ordo Templi Orientis, a title bestowed on him by mentor Aleister Crowley, a flamboyant occultist, British and American intelligence asset, and avid Nazi sympathizer and propagandist both before and during World War II. Crowley had assumed the leadership of the OTO in 1922 when founder Theodor Rus, a German occultist and intelligence asset, had stepped down. The OTO then, along with the various organizations spawned from it, is in a direct line of descent from the German occult-based secret societies that gave rise to the Third Reich, a fact made evident by the ideology and symbolism of the Process Church, whose logo is a modified swastika. Back in the Bay Area, Anton Zander LaVey and Crowley enthusiast Kenneth Enger would set about busily organizing the Church of Satan in San Francisco, where LaVey would become something of a celebrity, the clown prince of Satanism. From this church would spring forth both the Temple of Set, led by U.S. intelligence asset and psychological warfare specialist Lieutenant Colonel Michael Aquino, and the Werewolf Order, founded by LaVey's daughter Zena and Manson admirer Nicholas Schreck. Both of these offshoots embraced an unabashedly fascist ideology. The Werewolf Order was patterned directly after the Nazi Front Werewolf Corps created in post-war Germany to thwart any attempts at denazification. Zena LaVey and Nicholas Schreck are also notable for holding a public gathering on August 8, 1988 to celebrate the anniversary of the slaughter of Sharon Tate by the Manson family. So great is Aquino's admiration for Nazi Germany that he once paid a visit to Welsberg Castle, a satanic holy ground owing to the fact that the castle was lavishly restored by Heinrich Himmler to serve as the headquarters of the Black Order of the SS, to perform a satanic working. Interestingly, Aquino considers himself to be a homunculus, a being created by magic, the result of a working performed by Jack Parsons and L. Ron Hubbard. Aquino, who before splitting with the group was the highest-ranking member of the Church of Satan other than LaVey, has said that LaVey secretly forged an alliance with the National Renaissance Party, an overtly racist, neo-Nazi organization. This is not difficult to believe, given that LaVey's writings can best be characterized as religious fascism. From this primordial stew would arise, in the late 60s, the Manson family. Much of Manson's ideology was taken directly from the teachings of the Process Church, with whom Charlie was closely connected, as alluded to by Bugliosi in Helter Skelter, and greatly elaborated on by Ed Sanders in The Family, to verify that both satanic and Nazi imagery and philosophy are integral to the teachings of The Family, pay a visit to the official family website, maintained for Charlie by longtime disciple Sandra Good. Sanders links Manson as well to the Church of Satan and the OTO, as well as the Church of Scientology, as was true of Berkowitz as well. All of these connections are quite well documented in Terry's and Sanders' books. For instance, two of the Manson family members convicted of murder were recruited directly from LaVey's Church of Satan, Susan Sexy Sadie Atkins and Bobby Cupid Beausoleil, who is said to be a former lover and roommate of Kenneth Enger. LaVey in fact provides one of many connections between killers and victims. He had formed a close association with Roman Polanski shortly before the murders, when he served as the technical consultant for Polanski on his film Rosemary's Baby, in which he also made a cameo appearance as, who else, Satan. Newspaper accounts at the time of the slayings were rife with claims that the Polanskis were Satanists who hosted drug and sex orgies. But here I digress. The point is that the Manson family had numerous affiliations with an array of satanic groups. In fact, Terry's evidence indicates that the family was, and is, a satanic cult itself, a faction of the Process Spawn Qing'an cult and a sister group to the New York chapter responsible for the Son of Sam slayings. The family was, appropriately enough, deeply involved in drug trafficking, as Henry Lee Lucas claimed his cult to be. It's likely not a coincidence that Otis Toole was known to have paid visits to the Process Church headquarters in New Orleans. Further evidence presented by Terry indicates that another sister group was in operation in the 60s and 70s in the San Francisco, Santa Cruz area, with this interlocking network quite possibly responsible for the Zodiac murders as well. With all this in mind, we now turn our attention to the Santa Cruz area and the explosion of violent murders that belched forth from that cauldron. In March of 1967, Charles Mills Manson was released from prison and given transport to San Francisco, where, despite having served virtually his entire adult life in prison, He immediately started gathering followers, many recruited from the various satanic groups blossoming in the area. In the spring of the following year, 1968, Manson loaded his new followers into a bus and took them on the road, ultimately settling into the Los Angeles area where he quickly and improbably established numerous prominent contacts in the entertainment business. In December of 1968, what was thought to be the first of the Zodiac murders rocked the San Francisco area. It would later be learned that the killings actually began in the Los Angeles area on October 30, 1966, shortly after the rampages of Richard Speck and Charles Whitman. Others would soon follow. On August 9 and 10 of 1969, the Manson family committed two of the most notorious multiple murders in the nation's history, the Tate-LaBianca slayings, victims of which included Sharon Tate, the daughter of Colonel Paul Tate of U.S. Army Intelligence. Meanwhile, elsewhere in the country, a man named Stanley Baker was convicted in July of 1970 for the murder of a Montana resident. Baker candidly admitted to his arresting officers that he had a little problem, he was a cannibal. As proof, he produced from his pocket a well-gnawed human finger. Baker, as it turns out, liked to talk and candidly admitted his involvement in numerous other murders that he claimed to have committed as a member of the aforementioned 4P cult. In fact, police were able to conclusively link him to a particularly brutal mutilation murder in San Francisco, thanks to his having thoughtfully left behind a bloody fingerprint. California courts nevertheless declined to prosecute Baker for the homicide with the ridiculous claim that he had been denied a speedy trial. Despite his confessed involvement in a number of murders, and despite the fact that the murder he was convicted of involved him ripping out the man's heart and eating it, Baker was released from prison after just 14 years and remains at large today. This was perhaps due to the fact that he had distinguished himself as a model prisoner during his incarceration by starting his own satanic cult and having no fewer than 11 weapons confiscated by guards, the theme of inexplicably lenient treatment by the criminal justice system, already mentioned in conjunction with Henry Lee, will be more fully explored later. Just months after the conviction of Baker, in a case closely mirroring the slaughter of the residents of the Tate House, John Lindley Frazier, allegedly acting alone, killed all the occupants of a home in Santa Cruz, including a prominent doctor, his wife, secretary, and two children. As a grand finale, he threw the bodies in the pool, largely cleansing them of forensic evidence, and then lit the house on fire. Frazier, who was known to have a strong interest in the occult, was said to have started his own lifestyle as an Aquarian Age hermit, living in a 6-foot square shack in the woods. Can you say Ted Kaczynski, who was, by the way, a subject of MKUltra experiments while a student at Harvard? Not long after Frazier's rampage, and while the death toll of the Zodiac Killer continued to rise, Edmund Kemper began his bloody odyssey through the streets of Santa Cruz, ultimately leaving 8 dead before being stopped in early 1973. Most of his victims were beheaded and dissected, as well as being cannibalized and sexually abused after their death. Just 5 months after Kemper claimed his first victim, Herbert Mullen began a parallel series of killings in, where else? Santa Cruz. Mullen also admitted to having a strong interest in the occult, a fact made evident by the nature of the killings attributed to him. His first victim was killed on Friday the 13th, his second on or about Halloween. His third killing was the stabbing of a Catholic priest in his confessional on November 2nd, All Souls Day. This may have been a politically motivated hit. The victim, Father Henri Domey, was a hero of the anti-fascist French resistance movement during World War II. Mullen would be credited with 13 killings in just 4 months before being stopped in February of 1973. While awaiting trial on the charges, he was assigned a cell adjoining none other than Ed Kemper. The two were, inexplicably, represented by the same defense attorney, James Jackson, who had not long before represented fellow Santa Cruz mass murderer John Frazier. Even more inexplicably, all three were examined after their arrest by psychiatrist Donald Lund, who appeared as a witness in all three trials. Apparently, there aren't many defense attorneys or psychiatric witnesses available in Santa Cruz. Mullen attempted to refuse the services of Attorney Jackson, but the judge denied his request. For those who have lost count, that makes six serial killers, mass murderers: Charles Manson, Stanley Baker, John Lindley Frazier, Edmund Kemper, Herbert Mullen, and the Zodiac, all spawned from the Santa Cruz, San Francisco area in a span of just over 4 years, a rather remarkable geographic anomaly that has never been addressed. These killers were part of the dawn of a new era that would see serial killers become a never-present part of the American culture. Prior to 1960, fewer than two serial killers a year were reported nationwide. By 1970, the number had climbed to six per year, and by 1980 had tripled that figure. By 1990, nearly three dozen serial killers a year were being reported. Not surprisingly then, the rash of satanic murders afflicting California would continue. In 1977, not far from San Francisco, another serial killer began a string of killings. Richard Chase, dubbed the Vampire of Sacramento, would soon stand accused of six homicides that were laced with satanic symbolism, including the ritual mutilation of the left breast of one of his female victims and the drinking of his victim's blood. This preoccupation with the left breast of victims was shared by the Ripper crew, who routinely severed and cannibalized the left breast of their victims. In the Boston Strangler case, one of the victims was found with 18 stab wounds forming a design on her left breast, and Ray Sandez Ramirez, aside from his killings in the U.S., is suspected in the ritual murders of as many as 187 women in Juarez, Mexico, many of whom had their left breast severed. Yet another satanic serial killer was to terrorize California in 1984, the highly publicized night stalker, Richard Ramirez. Ramirez's involvement in Satanism was so flagrant that it was impossible for the press to ignore. He was routinely referred to as a self-styled Satanist, however, which is clearly not the case. In truth, Ramirez was connected to at least one high-profile satanic church, and likely to a covert cult as well. Ramirez was first introduced to Satanism at a young age by his older cousin Mike in, of all places, El Paso, Texas, or possibly even earlier by his father, a former policeman in Juarez, Mexico. Mike was a decorated Green Beret who had served as a special forces operative in Vietnam. Chances are that cousin Mike was in fact a Phoenix Program assassin, who clearly relished the opportunity that Vietnam gave him to engage in his bloodlust. Mike had documented some of his assignments in Vietnam by taking graphic Polaroid photos depicting rape, extreme torture, mutilation, and murder. These he shared with his young cousin Richard. There is reason to believe that Mike also got Richard involved with a cult, which certainly don't seem to be in short supply in the El Paso area. Richard left El Paso in 1978 and journeyed to California, where he quickly hooked up with LaVey's Church of Satan, where he was honored with a one-on-one meeting with LaVey. It is claimed that he parted company with LaVey's group before his killing spree began, though his interest in Satanism clearly continued, as evidenced by the symbolism attending the Night Stalker crime scenes, including the drawing of pentagrams. Also described as a dabbler in Satanism was everyone's favorite cannibal, Jeffrey Dahmer. It is likely that Dahmer was much more than just a dabbler, a fact made clear by the detailed plan for constructing a satanic altar that was found in his apartment, complete with the human skulls he had been collecting. In one of the most bizarre coincidences surrounding America's serial killers, the brother of one of Dahmer's victims was found stabbed to death in March of 1999, long after Dahmer himself had been murdered, in what was described by police as a ritual sacrifice. This would tend to indicate that others were involved in Dahmer's murder spree, though it is possible that it was just a coincidence. Given, however, that satanic crime is said to be so rare in America that it does not in fact exist, one wonders what the odds are of two kids from the same family being murdered under such circumstances. And while we are on the subject of coincidences, what are the odds that the Steiner family would have one son kidnapped as a child and subjected to 8 years of torture and sexual abuse, only to have their other son later turn out to be a serial killer? But here again I digress. Yet another obvious Satanist in the serial killer crowd is the man who was known as the Butcher of Kansas, Bob Burdella. By his own admission, Burdella turned to Satanism after the death of his father when he was still a teen. Among the array of macabre artifacts found in his home and place of business, Bob's Bizarre Bazaar, were numerous items fashioned from human body parts, as well as an abundance of occult literature and a satanic ritual robe. Another rather curious fact about the Burdella case was that following his conviction, a local millionaire named Deldoon Miri bought all of Burdella's belongings, including the house in which the murders were committed and the entire inventory of his home and business. He proceeded to level the house and then sold the vacant lot. It is quite possible that these actions were taken to hide evidence of the involvement of others, including possibly himself. It will be recalled that Henry Lee Lucas claimed that the upper echelons of the cult he was involved with included the wealthy and powerful. Berkowitz made the same claims of the Son of Sam cult. Journalist Terry was, in fact, able to document the involvement in the cult of such figures as Cotton Club film producer Roy Radin and wealthy art dealer Andrew Crespo. Crespo actually admitted to being present at a ritual homicide, though he denied participating in the grisly murder. Radin, on the other hand, became a victim of the cult himself. Another acknowledged Satanist was Leonard Lake, and likely his partner Charles N.G. as well. Lake's ex-wife admitted that her former spouse had a long-time affiliation with a San Francisco witch's coven, and friends recalled that Lake had often claimed membership in a secret death cult. Besides the killers listed here who have exhibited an overt interest in Satanism, it is tempting to conclude that any murder that includes such elements as cannibalism, ritual mutilation and necrophilia is satanically inspired. To do so, however, would reek of Christian fundamentalism with its desire to cast all such evil as the work of the devil. We will refrain from doing so here. We will also pause here to note that your erstwhile reporter is not, by any stretch of the imagination, a Christian fundamentalist. In fact, he is not a Christian at all, but rather an atheist. He does not believe in God or Satan, though he does believe that both are concepts that are used by the powerful few to promote an agenda. He also does not believe that those who are at the top of the food chain on either side of the aisle believe in God or Satan, for that matter. They merely exploit the belief systems of their followers to serve their own ends. The main point here is that readers should not conclude that the actions of these killers is influenced or directed by an entity known as Satan, but by mortal men who manipulate the belief systems of others. I'm glad we cleared that up, but once again I digress. Satan gets into people and makes them do things they don't want to. Herbert Mullin speaking to a Bible study class. We turn now to another of the recurrent themes that runs through the serial killer literature, the inexplicably lax treatment afforded America's serial killers, already noted in reference to Henry Lee Lucas, Richard Speck, and Stanley Baker. This trend is all the more remarkable in light of the fact that the U.S. has the harshest criminal justice system in the free world. So leniently have many of our serial killers been treated that it is hard not to conclude that the actions of America's courts and key law enforcement personnel are often deliberately intended to keep these men on the streets. If this is not the case, then it is difficult to imagine what other explanation would suffice to explain these glaring exceptions to the rule of law. John Wayne Gacy, for instance, was convicted in 1968 of violently raping a teenage boy. For this he was sentenced to 10 years, but was released after serving just 18 months. Some years later, during the killing years of 1972 to 1978, at least two young men would go to the police with stories of being chloroformed by Gacy and being subsequently tortured and violently raped. Despite Gacy's record for engaging in exactly that type of behavior, the complaints were not believed by the police, who failed to take any action. Police did finally take action in December of 1978, searching Gacy's home in response to allegations made by yet another young man. They found driver's licenses and jewelry that appeared to belong to some of the missing boys, copious quantities of drugs, a stained rug, handcuffs, a homemade stock, police badges, a syringe and needles, and rope. Despite the discovery of this evidence, and the fact that the stench of death literally filled every corner of the house as it rose up through the floorboards from the 29 corpses rotting below, the police decided to take no action at that time and left to further research the case. Gacy would not be arrested for 8 more days, and then it was on drug charges unconnected to the murders. This triggered a second search of the house, though, that resulted in the discovery of the bodies. In between the first and second searches, Gacy actually invited officers into his home for drinks, and yet again they bafflingly failed to notice the unmistakable smell of decomposition. Police also aided Gacy by steadfastly refusing to list any of Gacy's victims as missing, preferring instead to consider them runaways. It was noted during the search, by the way, that Gacy's house was impeccably neat, as was that other infamous death house, Jeffrey Dahmer's Milwaukee apartment. Dahmer also received rather lax treatment from authorities both before and during his killing spree. In 1989, Dahmer had been convicted on molestation charges, for which he received only probation and 1 year on a work release program. Even this was too harsh, though, and a judge granted him early release after just 10 months, despite a letter from the prisoner's own father asking that he be held until he received treatment. Following his release, his probation officer failed to make a single visit to Dahmer's home, which, like Gacy's, reeked of death and decomposition. This would later become the basis of a lawsuit by survivors of some of Dahmer's victims, who plausibly contended that a single visit by the probation department would have put Dahmer out of business. Even more baffling is the fact that a 14-year-old boy, naked, bleeding and heavily drugged, was seen fleeing Dahmer's apartment by two women who called the police to report the incident. The police, upon their arrival, chose to believe Dahmer's story of a lover's quarrel, despite the fact that the women were still on the scene and angrily tried to inform the officers that they had seen the terror-stricken boy actively resisting Dahmer's efforts to restrain him, and despite the fact that the boy was clearly underage. Yet more inexplicable, the police claimed to have accompanied the pair back to Dahmer's apartment and to have noticed nothing amiss. This despite the fact that there was at the time a 3-day-old corpse on the bed with the attendant smell of death, not to mention an abundance of rather morbid artifacts. Nevertheless, the police left and Dahmer promptly proceeded to kill the boy and rape and disembowel the corpse. The mother of one of the women who had witnessed the boy fleeing called officers back after reading a newspaper story on a missing boy who closely resembled the naked young man, but her concerns were dismissed. Out of despair, she even contacted the local FBI office, but this was also to no avail. The case was considered closed, even though Dahmer was a convicted child molester who was still on probation, and even though the boy who police returned to the killer that night was the brother of the boy Dahmer had previously been convicted of molesting. The night stalker was another who received notably light sentencing. Convicted of rape while still in high school, he was let off without even receiving probation. And his mentor, Cousin Mike, was convicted of shooting his wife in the face, killing her in full view of the 13-year-old future serial killer. He was sent to a mental hospital from which he was released in less than 5 years. Following his release, he again assumed the role of mentor to Richard. Then there is the case of Bobby Joe Long, Henry's kin. Accused by his girlfriend of rape and battery, he was convicted of the latter. The verdict was set aside, however, when a judge received a letter from Long and, strangely enough, considered it a valid legal motion for a new trial and granted the prisoner's motion. At his new trial, Long was acquitted despite numerous credible witnesses who testified against him. Between the first and second trials, he was also convicted of sending obscene materials and making obscene phone calls to a 12-year-old girl. For this, he was sentenced to 6 months probation and 2 days in jail. Later, he was convicted of attempting to abduct a girl at gunpoint and received a $1,500 fine and 3 years probation. How much worse can it get, you ask? Consider the case of Gary Heidnik. He was arrested in 1978 when it was discovered that he had a woman chained in his basement. She had been repeatedly tortured and raped. Charged with kidnapping, rape, unlawful restraint and false imprisonment, Heidnik was convicted. He was back out by early 1983. A few years later, six more women would have to endure this same tortuous ordeal. Two of them would not survive. Or consider the case of Arthur Shawcross. Arthur had gone to Vietnam in 1968, and though records indicate he served as a supply clerk, he returned telling lurid tales of rape, torture, cannibalism, mutilation and dismemberment, can you say Phoenix? Upon his return, he promptly set fire to a local paper mill and a cheese factory, crimes for which he was sentenced to 5 years in prison. He served less than two. A year later, Shawcross raped, strangled, mutilated and cannibalized an 8-year-old girl and a 10-year-old boy. He also admitted returning on several occasions to have sex with the boy's rotting corpse. He received a 25-year sentence for the girl's death, but was never even charged with the boy's murder, despite the fact that he had confessed to the crime and showed investigators where the body lay. Shawcross was released just 15 years later, resulting in 11 more deaths. Or consider the case of Edmund Kemper. In 1964, young Ed shot both his grandparents in the head. Placed in the custody of the youth authority, Kemper was released after serving just 5 years for the double murder. Richard Speck was convicted of attacking a girl with a knife and nearly killing her in January 1965, just a year before the Chicago mass murder. He served just 5 months, despite having been arrested some 36 times in his life prior to the assault. This was attributed to bureaucratic error. As the trial was set to begin for Hillside Strangler Angelo Buono, prosecutors moved to dismiss all 10 murder charges and drop prosecution altogether of Buono as the strangler. The judge, to his credit, refused to grant the motion and instructed the prosecutors to proceed with the case. Richard Chase was released from psychiatric confinement in 1976 despite protests from the staff that he was dangerous, due in part to his professed belief that he required the blood of others to survive. His killings began the next year, but not before his being found by the police in the desert naked and covered in blood. In his car nearby were guns and a bucket of human blood. Albert DeSalvo, purportedly the Boston Strangler, was arrested in 1955 and charged with molesting a 9-year-old girl. The charges were dropped. In the next few years, he was twice arrested for breaking and entering. Both times he received suspended sentences. In 1960, he was again convicted of breaking and entering in conjunction with a series of sexual assaults. He served just 11 months. And consider finally the cases of Charles Manson and Ted Bundy. The LAPD, arguably the most corrupt police department in the country, though there is certainly no lack of competition, couldn't really be bothered with the wealth of evidence that implicated family members in the Tate and LaBianca murders. The department refused to acknowledge and examine the glaringly obvious connections between the two murder scenes, thus severely hampering the investigation. They likewise refused to explore the connections between the Gary Hinman murder and the other two more high-profile crimes. The LA sheriffs had solved the Hinman case, no thanks to the LAPD, and had Bobby Beausoleil in custody and knew of his connections to the family. They were also well aware of the connections between the three crime scenes. Two motorcycle gang members with close ties to the family, Al Springer and Danny DiCarlo of the Straight Satans, had given them damning testimony concerning the family's involvement in all the murders. When the sheriffs passed this information on to the LAPD, they proceeded to do absolutely nothing. Meanwhile, on September 1, 1969, just a few weeks after the Tate murders, a gun was found and turned into LA's finest. The gun was a rather rare and unique firearm, and just happened to match the description of the weapon suspected of being used in the murders, right down to the broken handle. Nevertheless, the department tagged and filed away the weapon, where it was promptly forgotten. For months, it took a phone call from the father of the boy who had found the gun to get the department to acknowledge its existence, and even then he was initially told that it had probably been destroyed. It hadn't, and was in fact the weapon used to kill the victims at the Tate House. Elsewhere, Susan Atkins had been arrested on unrelated charges and was spending some time in the Sybil Brand Institute for Women. While there, she gave detailed confessions of the murders to two fellow inmates. Both of these women tried repeatedly to pass this information along to the LAPD, but were consistently denied permission to do so, despite the fact that one of the women to whom these requests were made was at the time dating one of the Tate case homicide detectives. In other words, the LAPD had at its disposal the eyewitness accounts of a participant in the crime, the gun used in the crime, the statements of two close associates of the killers directly implicating them in the crime, among other evidence, and yet chose to do nothing for a period of several months. Ted Bundy, on the other hand, had already been taken into custody when his comedy of errors began. The problem was that, in some kind of surrealistic Keystone Cops scenario, they just couldn't seem to keep him there. In 1975, Bundy was convicted of the kidnapping and assault of Carol Duranc. For this, he was sentenced to 15 years with the possibility of parole, meaning that he likely would have been back on the streets in record time. Shortly thereafter, Colorado police filed murder charges against Bundy, greatly overdue considering that at least five people, including one of Bundy's college professors and, on more than one occasion, his own fiancée, had given the police Bundy's name in connection with a string of killings being investigated in Seattle and elsewhere. This information was filed away and forgotten for years. Now awaiting trial for murder, and suspected of numerous other murders, Bundy was granted permission to represent himself. Despite being an obvious security risk, he was allowed to do research in the courthouse library, unattended and unrestrained. Luckily for Ted, the library had an open window. Bundy escaped by jumping out the window and casually walking away to freedom. Recaptured after nearly a week on the lam, Bundy would escape again just months later. This time he was said to have exited his cell through the ceiling space and crawled into the living quarters of a deputy. He then dropped down from the